Now, I got immense pleasure in inviting Dr. Shashank Joshi. Nobody needs introduction, and he's a Padma Shri recipient. Just give them a big hand. I think in a medical fraternity, one among us, I think he achieved absolute miles, and he's an academician, and I know him personally. He's an amount of research and everything, the publications are mind-blowing, and he's current API president as well. I mean, I think his CV runs like 2-3 pages, but he's currently a consultant endocrinologist and metabolic physician in Leelavati Hospital in Mumbai. Over to you, Shashank.
Thank you for your kind words of introduction. I think Krishna has given us very unique topics, you know. I would really be very happy to exchange my topic with Murli on love, and he has made me fatigued. Okay.
But we are forming everything together to have a question
discussion
and answer
at the end.
Love and fatigue together, maybe?
Right. So I have to talk on fatigue, and then fatigue is a very boring condition, but I think it's one of the most common, maybe because I'm API president, he thought a physician's topic would be apt in order. So what I'm going to talk maybe in 18 or 20 minutes is what is fatigue and what is chronic fatigue, because chronic fatigue has a lot of neuroendocrine connect. There are a lot of endocrine conditions with fatigue, and for endocrinologists and non-endocrinologists, I don't want to discuss adrenal insufficiency or hypothyroidism. I'm just going to give you a couple of conditions which cause fatigue, which are endocrine in origin. But what I'm going to do a little more on is a very, very ill-defined term called chronic fatigue syndrome. And there is a lot of endocrinology involved with that now. And I probably, philosophical Krishna had that in mind. Okay. And there's another entity very closely linked with CFS. Again, a very, very ill-defined entity in practice called fibromyalgia. And that also has a neuroendocrine connect now. And there's more and more work on it. Of course, the data is very scanty on that. And I'm going to just touch a little bit upon another entity, which is not technically fatigue, but people come, elderly people come with fatigue. They're often frail, they're often sarcopenic, they often are looking at hormone replacement, and they're looking at functional anabolic therapies. So I'm just going to give a passing mention to that in that issue. So when we talk of fatigue, what is definition of fatigue? It's basically a difficulty or inability initiating activity, perception of generalized weakness, reduced capacity maintaining activity, so people very easily, and difficulty in concentration, memory, emotional stability. In fact, people postprandial, he has kept this talk. If you are a little sleepy, and I can see half of you all are sleepy in this talk, okay, that means you're fatigued, you know, it's a manifestation of fatigue. And mental fatigue is one of them. Now, there are two types of fatigue. The duration of fatigue could be recent, it could be less than 1 month. It could be prolonged, which is more than 1 month but less than 6 months. And it could be chronic, which is more than 6 months. And presence of chronic fatigue necessarily does not imply chronic fatigue syndrome. That's a separate entity altogether. We don't have prevalence data of fatigue in India. But if you walk to any practitioner's clinic across specialties, I think 80% of your patients will complain of fatigue at some point of time. And even us as individuals in our lifetime, in every day, you will have some point where you will feel tired or fatigued. So if you look at the UK and US surveys in population base, it's a symptom which is around 6 to 7.5%. And a cross-sectional survey of US workers found that 2-week period of prevalence of fatigue was 38%. And the annual cost to employers exceeded $136 billion, which is lost in productive work time because of just a simple entity called fatigue. And it is estimated that in primary care settings in the US, around 21 to 33% patients seek attention reporting significant fatigue. And it results in the US every year around 7 million office visits to a doctor. Endocrine conditions are extremely well known with fatigue. Adrenal insufficiency takes the prime, hypothyroidism, growth hormone deficiency, hypopituitary states, hypogonadism, and frailty in the elderly. But as I said, when you talk of fatigue endocrinology, you need to talk of CFS and fibromyalgia. What is chronic fatigue syndrome? It's an unexplained, persistent, and debilitating fatigue. Living with CFS is very frustrating for most people and worse for healthcare providers, because there is a very limited understanding why and how CFS develops, and very limited treatment options are available. Probably the only significant treatment option for CFS is cognitive behavioral therapy given by a good counselor. Although CFS is not likely to shorten your life, it completely affects quality of your life. And many of the patients who are technically termed as CFS have been subclinical adrenal insufficiency. So it may be still worthwhile doing an ACT stim test to rule out that. In the recent years, they have generated a lot of neuroendocrine hypothesis for CFS. And there have been a lot of reports to show that neuroendocrine hypofunction, probably of hypothalamic origin, is responsible for chronic fatigue states. And a tendency for hypocortisolism has been identified very inconsistently with CFS patients. People have called it as a relative hypocortisolism state, and they may reflect it as a primary abnormality in CFS. Some people think, no, this is just a disorder of brain regulation or hypothalamic regulation, and there are peripheral elements of stress system, and the stress or the psycho-neuro-immuno-endocrinology of stress is very ill-defined again. And there is a reasonable evidence to suggest that hypocortisolism might contribute to CFS symptomatology. Also, it has been the neuroendocrine studies in CFS have led to contradictory results. Smaller studies have been confounded with differences between subgroups of CFS patients, duration of fatigues, presence of concomitant hypotension and orthostasis, autonomic dysfunction, presence and absence of depression, familial occurrence. So therefore, there has been no concordance at all. So there is no real data to come in. The other challenge which occurs is there is a melancholic major depression associated with mild hyper or hypocortisolism. And therefore, we are not sure whether the CFS hypocortisolism and the melancholic major depression mild hypocortisolism, which is co-associated, actually sort of neutralizes each other. Also, hypocortisolism is a trait shared by a lot of other idiopathic chronic disorders. The most typical among them is post-traumatic stress disorder, particularly seen with soldiers after a war. If you do their cortisol axis after a war or a conflict, you will, and those who have PTSD, you will see that they will have some amount of hypocortisolic state. Fibromyalgia and inflammatory disorders like asthma or rheumatoid arthritis. So what is the stress response to CFS? It's a complex physiological mechanism, and it's probably a real or perceived threat to homeostasis. So it's the flight and fright response. And it's generally accepted that it's adaptive and primarily designed to re-establish homeostasis response is led to an excessive or prolonged activation of stress system, which disturbs normal physiology. The response to stressors is by two physiological systems. One is the HPA axis, the hypothalamo-pituitary-adrenal axis, of which cortisol is a major mediator. And the second, which is more classically known, is the sympathoadrenal axis, which produces catecholamines, epinephrine and norepinephrine. Both glucocorticoids and catecholamines widely mediate our stress responses of our body, and which we know this very well. We also know that whenever the hypothalamo-pituitary-adrenal axis is activated, what happens is there is stimulation of the paraventricular neurons of the paraventricular nucleus of the hypothalamus, which release neuropeptides CRH and arginine vasopressin AVP into the hypophyseal portal blood system. The combined CRH and AVP on the anterior pituitary corticotropes stimulates ACTH, and the circulating ACTH works on the zona fasciculata of the adrenal cortex to stimulate cortisol synthesis. This basal unstressed cortisol acts to prevent arterial hypotension by augmenting the effects of catecholamines, maintains normoglycemia through an insulin counter-regulatory axis. So that's a typical response, and that is how it works through a very nice network. We also know that ACTH secretion is influenced by stress. A circadian rhythm exists, and a negative feedback to hypothalamus also exists. During acute stress, the amplitude and synchronization of CRH ABP pulsations in the hypothalamo-portal system markedly increases. This results in excess increase in ACTH and cortisol secretory episodes. So obviously, the stress-induced cortisol secretion activates CNS, increases blood pressure, elevates blood glucose, and suppresses the immune and inflammatory response to prevent the tissue damage. We also know that cortisol basically works through cytosolic ubiquitous glucocorticoid receptors. And free cortisol, unbound to CBG, diffuses through cell membrane, binds to the carboxy terminal end of the cytosolic glucocorticoid receptor, and on corticoid binding, the ligand receptor complex translocates into the nucleus, where it interacts with GREs, which is nothing but glucocorticoid responsive elements, within the DNA to activate gene transcription. These activated receptors inhibit transcription factors like CGN, CFOS, NF kappa beta, which are positive regulators for transcribing genes involved in activation and growth of immune and other cells. So obviously, when chronic fatigue disorders occur, a lot of studies have been done. There are two unique different heritable disorders of the axis of hypothalamo-pituitary-adrenal axis, which have been described with fatigue as a primary symptom. These include, one, glucocorticoid resistance due to glucocorticoid receptor abnormalities, and mutations of CBG gene, the chief cortisol transport protein. These disorders are very, very rare, but they reinforce the notion that primary pituitary adrenal abnormalities may produce chronic fatigue symptoms. And studies of broader CFS patient groups generally detected relative hypocortisolism and the altered dynamic responses may provide an indirect evidence that there is a CNS understimulation of the pituitary adrenal system or function. So the glucocorticoid resistance, or the familial glucocorticoid resistance, is a very rare syndrome, which is characterized by diminished tissue effect of cortisol as a result of glucocorticoid receptor defect. And glucocorticoid resistance is generally due to loss of function, mutation of the glucocorticoid receptor gene, although the genetic defect has not been identified in all cases. Decreased sensitivity to cortisol results in activation of HPA axis and increased ACTH and cortisol levels. In most cases, elevated cortisol levels sufficiently compensate to overcome the hormonal resistance, and therefore there is no clinical manifestation of cortisol excess or deficiency. Increased ACTH results in mineralocorticoid and androgen levels, resulting in hypertension and hirsutism, but fatigue is probably the only isolated symptom described in a 55-year-old woman with glucocorticoid resistance. Fatigue in this patient was intermittent, blood pressure was constantly in low normal range, no postural hypertension, and was sufficient to prohibit this lady from full-time work. Urinary cortisol levels were elevated, as were the plasma cortisol levels, and the thermolabile glucocorticoid receptor was noted with temperature-induced reduction in dexamethasone binding, although specific glucocorticoid receptor mutation was not reported in this case, and it is proposed that fatigue in this lady or in such cases was a result of insufficient overproduction of cortisol. Further to this, there are recent studies to show that polymorphisms of the glucocorticoid receptors have been found in association with certain haplotypes and chronic fatigue syndrome. But it is very, very speculative at this stage to establish a cause-effect relationship between the two. The other thing is, a lot of CBG, corticosteroid binding abnormalities, also known as transcortin, which is a high affinity transporter glycoprotein for cortisol, have been reported with chronic fatigue, and some of them have been linked to severe illness and is a part of chronic illness. In fact, the mutations in the CBG genes, as indicated in this diagram, have been documented with fatigue with a genetic axis. What are the pituitary adrenal hormone abnormalities in chronic fatigue? And this has been in consistent research all the time. People have studied that a lot. They have looked at debilitating fatigue and a low circulating cortisol. Typically, it is seen with Addison's disease, glucocorticoid withdrawal, bilateral adrenalectomy. All these three conditions are classically associated with fatigue, where other symptoms with CFS are arthralgia, myalgia, disturbed sleep and mood. And however, the literature has a lot of inconsistent data in this regard. What about the other data? can we give steroids? Now the data relative suggesting that relative hypocortisolism in CFS with coexisting fatigue, with low blood pressure and mood alteration has been seen both in Addison's and CFS. And that led to trials of corticosteroids in chronic fatigue syndrome. In fact, there was a randomized control trial with 32 CFS patients with low dose hydrocortisone, and there was not a very great response. There were two larger trials with hydrocortisone treatment with CFS, and all those trials were negative. They did not show, even fludrocortisone has been tried with chronic fatigue syndrome, and they did not show that there was any major benefit. In fact, the current scientific data indicates that the symptomatic benefit achieved with hydrocortisone or fludrocortisone replacement at best is marginal and is associated with clinically significant adverse events, including adrenal suppression of features of glucocorticoid excess. So adverse effects outweigh any perceived benefits of treatment, and therefore neither hydrocortisone nor fludrocortisone is recommended or justified in patients with CFS. In addition, ACTH stimulation testing has no practical relevance in routine assessment of CFS patients. It should not be used to formulate management decisions. So that is the current take-home message from this whole CFS entity. Although low cortisol may not be the chief source of disability in CFS, it could be a marker for therapeutic significance. What do I mean by that? As I told you, the only treatment for CFS is cognitive behavioral therapy. And people who have lower urinary free cortisol or an altered diurnal rhythm of cortisol, their response to CBT is poorer. That's all which we can conclude from the current literature. And therefore, CFS is a very ill-defined entity. And let us move to the next fatigue endocrinology disorder, which is fibromyalgia. Again, fibromyalgia is a chronic musculoskeletal pain. Fibromyalgia patients are in two cohorts. Either they are depressed, anxious, with depression as a comorbid condition, and with tenderness and a lot of cataphorizing with low control. Or they could be not depressed, not anxious, and a lot of tenderness. So they can be high tenderness patients and low tenderness or moderate tenderness patients. So these are soft tissue pain disorders. So what is the role of endocrine axis? Because there's a lot of peptides, neuropeptides involved in fibromyalgia generation. When one looks at data of hypothalamo-pituitary adrenal axis in fibromyalgia, there's a reasonable amount of data which has been studied that a lot of functional abnormalities of HPA axis in fibromyalgia. But these are all very heterogeneous. They have also found some abnormal levels of growth hormones in some cases and abnormal levels of sex hormones, especially in female fibromyalgia cases compared to controls. But no conclusive remarks can be made on fibromyalgia neuroendocrinology currently. Let me move to the last part of my talk, which is a very, very exciting new functional promoting anabolic therapies for sarcopenia and frailty associated with aging. And fatigue in elderly is very, very common. We all know that with age, our lean mass goes down, muscle strength goes down, physical function comes down. So obviously, people above 65 have a difficulty in performing activities of daily life as the age progresses. Typically, look at this history. 70-year-old man with weakness, fatigue, difficulty in walking and climbing stairs, hypertension, diabetes, myocardial infarction 6 years ago, little chest pain with exertion, urinate 3 times a day, okay, poor stream of urine with urgency, takes metformin, lisinopril, metoprolol, heart rate, blood pressure is okay, testes are soft, okay, glucose and creat is okay, testosterone might be a little low, FSH-LH is okay. Should this man receive testosterone therapy? So there have been lot of these functional anabolic promoting therapies. Either they are orexigenic agents, none of them are approved, like megestrol or the cannabinoids or the ghrelin mimetics or the MCR antagonists. These are all being developed. What are most popular are the pro-myogenic agents or the muscle building agents, which are mediated via the androgen receptor. Most typical being testosterone. And now there are new compounds, which are the SARMs, steroidal and non-steroidal. Of course, there are WNT activators, which are non-androgen, like follistatin. There are myostatin analogs. There are IGF-1 mediated mechanisms like growth hormone and its secretagogues or ghrelin mimetics. And then there are agents which are anti-catabolic agents like anti-cytokine, anti-glucocorticoid, inhibitors of atrophy, and so on and so forth, or anti-apoptotic. So fundamentally, what has been looked at is the role of testosterone. We also know that skeletal muscle mass is fundamentally regulated with growth and atrophy, and we have a role in that. And there is a whole new therapy which has emerged called pro-myogenic functional therapies. Let us look at testosterone. You can see here, whether it's HIV or COPD, both are fatigue states. And in both these states, testosterone therapy improves muscle mass and strength in men with HIV and COPD. There's very good data. If you look at meta-analysis published by Snyder quite some time back on effect of testosterone on physical function, there was no significant overall impact on quality of life. However, there was a great improvement on physical function domain from the placebo. And Shali Basin reproduced the same study a little later. So obviously, there has been some failure to demonstrate improvements of performance-based measures of physical function, because either the increments of testosterone levels were small, there was a problem in measuring muscle performance, there were inclusion of healthy males without any physical limitations, and older men may be insensitive to anabolic effect of androgens. So the TORM trial, which was published in NEJM in 2010, looked at testosterone in older men with mobility limitation. And this was a double-blind randomized trial where they give transdermal testosterone gel. And they looked at target population of 65 plus mobility limitation, a free testo less than 50 picograms or total testo less than 350 nanograms. There was a mobility limitation, either as a reported, self-reported difficulty in walking or climbing stairs. And they enrolled these subjects and they looked at the various baseline values giving transdermal testosterone. Unfortunately, there was an increased frequency of cardiovascular and dermatological events, of the adverse events in the men assigned to the testosterone arm. And therefore, the TIRES Data Safety Monitoring Board recommended cessation and enrollment of treatment discontinuation due to increased frequency of CV adverse events. So that was rather disappointing. So the CV events of testosterone trials have been yo-yoing all the time. The meta-analysis published shows that it could be on either side of the graph, but there have been more favoring placebo and less favoring testosterone. What is the probable reason of increased frequency of CV events in TOM trials and not in other trials? Because it was older men, higher burden of chronic conditions, and underreporting of ADRs in other clinical trials. Smaller trials can yield results which are different from larger trials, and trials stopped early can tend to overestimate treatment effects or side effects. Also, we know that lipids, hematocrit, salt water needs to be looked at more critically. And therefore, we have a different issue and a different outcome. So remember, older men with mobility limitation have a high burden of fatigue and chronic conditions. Testosterone administration may have higher CV events, and therefore frail older limitations may need anabolic therapy, but they have to weigh their outcomes with CV outcomes. And therefore, there probably needs to be another group of functional improvements for muscle strength gain in this elderly cohort or population. And that is leading to a birth of a new group of drugs called selective androgen receptor modulators, SARMs. These are signaling molecules like follistatin, which activate testosterone, promote myogenesis, but downstream the androgen receptor and beta-catectin. Now with the nanotechnology, they will have tissue selective delivery and they can be administered in lower doses with other functional producing androgen therapies for functional training. We all know that testosterone induces muscle fiber hypertrophy, it increases myonuclear and satellite cell number, it actually increases mesenchymal potential cells. And therefore, if you look at Sally Basin's hypothesis, this is androgen myostatin action on the muscle, how they are working. This is follistatin and WT signaling pathway, anti-follistatin. I wouldn't go into details of that, but this whole group of pro-myogenic drugs are being developed for this population where muscularity is an issue, and this has been documented very well. So this whole class of SARMs are being developed. They are all in different phases of their trials. There's an oral SARM which might improve lean body mass and muscle strength, and that could be coming up soon. So obviously there is a huge unmet need for functional promoting androgen therapies. There is unequivocal evidence that androgens increase muscle mass and have maximal voluntary strength. But the strategies to translate muscle mass and strength gums to functional improvements need to be ensured that they are dissociated from the benefits because of the adverse events. And therefore, we need to have drugs which are safer and are CV safe. We are also going to get pro-myogenic drugs, which will probably counter these adverse cardiometabolic effects. And therefore, we will have more therapies to come. So this is my last slide. What is fatigue in endocrinology all about? Well, fatigue, when we think in endocrinology, we think of adrenal, thyroid, gonads, and pituitary. We have to think of that because that's the commonest thing which we think as endocrinologists. But more often than that, we are disappointed. And then we lead to two ubiquitous conditions, which have neuroendocrine HPA axis abnormalities. They are very good as research tools, but the current data is very heterogeneous and disappointing, both for chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia. And the last point of fatigue in endocrinology is what is seen in the aging geriatric population. Elderly men, sarcopenia, need testosterone, but testosterone has CV challenges, and therefore we need to develop functional anabolic therapies which may emerge as a viable option for them. Thank you for a patient hearing.